Hello everyone, I'm Shail Mook. Early in my career, I formed a consulting company and started hiring developers. I made a lot of bad choices and some great ones too. I also passed many interviews and conducted some interviews for my clients. Unfortunately, I'm amazed at how bad companies are at interviewing and hiring. The goals are unclear, the metrics are uneven, and we set ourselves up for failure. I can't promise you will hire the right person after this, but I'm sure these tips will help you improve on that. One of the Slack groups I'm on had a discussion about interview candidates answering questions directly off of ChatGPT. This reminded me of an old blog I read where a writer complained about a candidate cheating in a virtual interview by Googling the answer and giving it in the interview. Obviously, I don't want to hire a person who's unreliable. Lying is an instant disqualification. In that sense, that person who looked up answers on Google would have been problematic for me too. But if you ask a bad interview question, don't be surprised if the person that's under duress will come up with a shortcut. This reminded me of this great joke, or is it a true story? Hard to tell. This person's spouse is learning programming and confesses that she's cheating by Googling the answers. The joke ends with, "Do I tell her?" We all know what the author means. We all Google coding stuff all the time. Even I do, and I programmed well over a decade before Google was founded. Obviously, there's a way to do this right, especially regarding intellectual property. But if you're testing something that's Googleable, then you're testing the wrong skill. Technical interviews questions would focus on things that are more relevant and not Googleable. The main problem I have with these sorts of interviews is that the goal is badly defined. When I ask a customer, "Who do you want to hire?" I get terrible answers like "the best programmer" or "the groan-inducing ninja developer." Thankfully, that went out of style. When I conduct a technical interview, I'm hiring a teammate. This teammate should be a person I want to work with. As a result, I focus on very different things than just the standard school test. The 2011 film Moneyball focuses on the true story of building a better baseball team by picking the undervalued players that can work better together as a team to get an overall better team. It's not a great film, but the concept is very solid. My biggest hiring mistakes were usually when I was blinded by the qualifications of a rock star developer and missed how well they would fit in the team. With that in mind, let's talk about the rules about coding interview. I don't do live coding. It's like watching paint dry. It's terrible and counterproductive. It represents nothing of our day-to-day job. Lots of developers have stage anxiety, and we can miss those great people simply because of that. Just don't do that. I'm not in high school, and I don't want homework. A company that expects me to do homework won't hear back from me. Candidates should be treated with respect in this regard. Take home tasks, don't teach us anything. You don't know how long a candidate spent on them or if they got any help. It's amazing to me that people agree to do them, but I guess it's the sad state of our industry. I have a very high score on Stack Overflow. All that says is that I spent a lot of time answering questions on Stack Overflow. It means I'm patient, but doesn't mean I'm a great coder or a great teammate. A person with a high score here might have more ego problems, I prefer ignoring the score for a technical position. I love puzzles like why are sewer covers round? These are fun brain teasers when making small talk with friends. I'm terrible at small talk. But for coding interviews, it's supposed to show how my mind works, does it? Why not ask something that's actually related to what we do? A lot of these videos suggest questions to ask or answer in a technical interview. This is the wrong approach. We need to think about how the interview is structured so we can give a level playing field to multiple candidates. This works in our interest as it gives us more options for negotiations. Forming a consensus about the candidate based on three separate interviews is something I learned from my time at Sun Microsystems. More would be too much as it would burden the candidate and make the consensus difficult. But having three people can eliminate natural biases and alleviate personal mistakes. Early in my career, I interviewed a young Russian immigrant, and in retrospect, I helped her answer because her English was so poor. I was biased favorably and wanted to help, but this didn't help her as she lost her job when it became clear she wasn't qualified. If I had additional feedback, we could have avoided that mistake. It's important that an interviewer would represent the same demographic of the candidate. A woman should be one of the interviewers for a woman, and in case of a racial ethnicity, we should have similar representation. Sadly, this isn't always possible, but it's essential when it's a big company. I worked with a young woman who was a fantastic developer, but very soft-spoken. I was shocked that she passed the interview because she spoke so softly and timidly. We need to give an opportunity for such individuals. They are often some of the best developers around. The obvious question is, what do we ask in these interviews? How do we guide our two colleagues about the technical interview? First, we need to each bring our own style. There's no one size fits all, but it's important to ask two general things, a technical challenge and have a conversation to gauge team fit. It might be counterintuitive, but fitting in the team is more important than anything. I'm a very opinionated person. In that sense, it's very difficult for me to work with someone who's similarly opinionated, but less capable. In a previous job, I had a CTO who was brilliant but different. We got along fine, and I respected his authority. Then, due to team changes, I had a manager who was smart but arrogant. He was ignorant about specific tasks and assumed one can explain it to him during a meeting because he's smart enough and he can get it. That chafed me the wrong way, and I quickly left the team. They hired him because he's smart and he was well-liked by other developers, but it broke the team and he left after I left. The hardest question I ever got in an interview was, tell me about a bug you made, how you tracked it and fixed it. I started telling the interviewer about a bug I tracked and he stopped me. Was it a bug you made? No, it wasn't. At this point, my mind went blank. I didn't want to admit that just a few weeks back, I placed the greater than operator in the wrong direction and spent a couple of days debugging that. I was lost. I passed the interview, but the interviewer got to see my weakness. I used to suppress my mistakes. That's common for younger, overconfident developers. It isn't a question that would fail you in an interview. It's a glimpse at who you are at this point in time. This is where the interview should go. I want to hear the story behind a problem or a conflict. What did you do when you disagreed with a teammate? at school, on a job? How did you communicate that? When were you wrong? Our ability to self-reflect and be honest about our mistakes makes us great teammates. It's okay when someone doesn't know. It's a conversation and should lead every interviewer in a different direction. I know I said that I'm against writing code in an interview, but I am for reading code in a technical interview. If I need to assess the capabilities of a developer, I'll point them at a GitHub project and ask them to find something. I'll describe a sort of bug and expect them to tell me how they would debug something like that. This is very hard for developers that are fresh out of college, but I gave it to a bootcamp graduate a couple of years ago. He passed. I helped him along the way, which is to be expected, but it showed me how he thinks and works, which is far more valuable than his opinion on the shape of a sewer cover. Here are some questions I've asked in the past. I want people who enjoy what they're doing. I want them to tell me what worked, what didn't work, what they can do better, and what they learned by creating a discussion around this. I need to form a mental image of the project. I love seeing people geek out on a project. If they don't, it's a serious warning sign. That's why I ask them to tell me about the last project you're passionate about. A debugging story tells me more about a candidate than anything else. People might draw a blank here or might take a while to find something, but these are engaging stories, so they're great for an interview. People need to describe the tools and techniques they use to track a bug. That's something you can only do with experience. That's why I ask, tell me about the last big bug you tracked. What was your process? When I was interviewing at a company, they asked me how I would scale a specific system for production. I could use a whiteboard, but honestly, this works okay verbally too. Making architectural decisions, explaining them, and then adapting based on additional consideration. That's core to what we do. You can ask dozens of questions like this. The nice thing about this is that you can even give them to candidates in advance and they can come prepared. You still wouldn't lose much of the value. It's something like, how would you implement something like X? I know interviews are stressful processes, kind of like dating. We feel judged. If you follow these guidelines, you get to meet interesting people and have interesting conversations. I learned a lot on interviews on both sides of the table. When they are done right, they are great and productive. Thanks for watching. Please check out my book and follow me for more videos like this. Thank you.